Welcome everyone. On behalf of the Neighbourhood Justice Centre, thank you for joining us this afternoon for this session exploring community justice and family violence. My name is Rebecca Hicks. I'm the Manager of Education and Public Programs at the NJC, and I'm delighted to be your host this afternoon for this session. Before introducing our guest speakers, I would like to say a few words about the Neighbourhood Justice Centre, or as we refer to it, the NJC. The NJC was established as an innovative community justice model designed to deliver a local justice response for the community in the city of Yarra, which is located in Victoria, Australia. It is Australia's only community justice centre, and also, you might know, it's the world's first international mentor community court. The NJC opened in 2007. This year we're celebrating our 15th anniversary to help improve the quality of life for the local community, aiming to do this by addressing the underlying reasons for people's offending, strengthening community capacity and resilience, and leading the way in justice innovation. Now, some of you might be thinking, so what is community justice and why does it matter? Community justice acknowledges that social problems contribute to crime and works with the community towards place-based solutions. It considers the impact of the justice system on the well-being of the people within it. It also strives to strengthen and improve the quality of life for the community by developing partnerships with residents, businesses, and other social services to coordinate the way public safety problems are addressed. And every community justice model around the world is unique, as they cater to the community's needs through the development of local specific solutions. Today, the NJC is part of the specialist courts and programs within the Magistrates Court of Victoria, and it is an internationally recognised community justice model, placing the community at the centre of the justice system. Now, before I introduce our speakers, I would also like to welcome and introduce the NJC's new magistrate who started earlier this year. Magistrate Noreen Toohey has been a magistrate for 26 years and before joining the NJC spent 16 years working in the western suburbs of Melbourne, 8 years in regional Victoria and 2 years at the Melbourne Coroner's Court. With a strong interest in therapeutic jurisprudence, Magistrate Toohey was the lead magistrate at the Specialist Family Violence Division at Ballarat until 2005. She's also a member of the Victorian Magistrates Family Violence and Family Law Portfolio Committee. We are very excited to welcome Magistrate Toohey to the NJC and also that she's here to speak with us. So I'm going to hand over to you, Magistrate Toohey.
Thanks very much, Rebecca. I thought at the outset, what I would do is just build on that description of my background that Rebecca has outlined. So I'm a specialist family violence magistrate, and I commenced when the family violence division was initiated in Ballarat in regional Victoria. That court is a multidisciplinary team of workers who assist respondents and applicants, specially trained prosecutors, specially trained lawyers. So ultimately, of course, what's incredibly important when dealing with family violence is that everyone understands the dynamics of family violence, what's causing the problem, how we then address that problem. The Royal Commission held in Victoria in 2016, of course, reinforced the need for a specialist approach in relation to family violence. What we all know is that family violence is learned behaviour. And in my experience at a specialist court, what I've found is there's absolutely no quick fix. We had a mandatory program in relation to counselling in Ballarat. And what I would see is I would see people coming back on a number of occasions, move on in a relationship, but they came back. But ultimately what I would hear from the counsellors is that behaviour was changing. So what we know is with the pandemic, there's been increased isolation. What that ultimately means for the community is that there's been higher risk. So ultimately, the question always is, how is the community going to respond? Because ultimately, this is all about ensuring safety and, of course, improving accountability. So we're fortunate at the NJC to have a team of specialist services, and of course that team works in the community. So I hope that you find this session is really helpful. Thanks very much, Rebecca.
Thank you, Magistrate Toohey, and also welcome again to the NJC. Today we are joined by Sophie Moore and also Nick Joseph to talk a little bit more about community justice and family violence, and also building on what Magistrate Toohey has shared with us. Nick Joseph is a family violence counsellor for No to Violence and is located at the NJC as the Family Violence Male Respondent Caseworker. Nick has experience working with men individually, in group settings, and via brief interventions. He is passionate about the work that he does and is committed to working with male respondents to see real impactful changes in behaviour. Nick is an expert in his field. He has designed and delivered workshops nationally for people working in the Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander family violence space. He also focuses on community capacity building by facilitating community-led programs. Now for Sophie. Sophie Moore is the Family Violence Program Coordinator in the NJC's Program Innovation Team. Her role is to develop and foster community partnerships that build community capacity, promote community justice, and contribute to a vibrant, safe, and inclusive city of Yarra. Sophie is a lawyer by training who specialises in capacity building and legal empowerment initiatives. Prior to joining the NJC, Sophie worked in the higher education and not-for-profit sectors, where she partnered with cold and newly arrived communities to co-design and deliver a range of projects to promote gender equality, multiculturalism, and access to justice. I'm going to hand over to you now, Sophie.
Thank you, Beck, and to Magistrate Toohey for that introduction. It's lovely to be with you here today and to see both some familiar and new faces and names in the audience. I would also like to begin by acknowledging the traditional owners and true sovereigns of the land on which I live and work, the Wurundjeri people of the Kulin Nation. And I also want to take a moment to acknowledge those who have been harmed by family violence. As Beck mentioned, my name's Sophie, my pronouns are she, her, and I'm the Family Violence Program Coordinator here at the Neighbourhood Justice Centre. So moving on to today's topic, the focus of today is exploring the NJC's approach to family violence within our broader model of community justice. So our approach here has three main elements, and I'll be taking you through the first. So I'm going to take us out of the courtroom into the community to explore how the NJC develops partnerships and engages with victim survivors, workers in the family violence sector, and the broader community. And then I'll hand back over to Nick, where we'll go back inside the courtroom to look at our model of specialist services here at the NJC, and also some of the court facilities and processes that we have in place to support perpetrators and victims of family violence. So moving on to the next slide, I thought that I would start today with some questions for you. So specifically, I'd like to talk about community. And again, feel free to please contribute via the chat function. So I'm curious to hear, how do you experience community? Through which interests or identity? This could be family, neighbourhood, work, sport, faith, culture, an online group, probably a combination of these. So I'll just pause here for a moment to let you write some answers and have a bit of a read. So again, that question was, how do you experience community? Through which interests or identity? So we have some notes here about through personal identity, shared interests, family, work and religious community, and also talking about the impact that COVID had, which is going to be my next question about how you engage with community. So through identities as a queer person, through school, those with common interests, spirituality, connection with others, friends, neighbours, culture, faith, teaching yoga, working in different community organisations. Again, lots of mentions of neighbours, colleagues, friends, people with similar interests and values. I'd now like to ask you, how has that changed during COVID? Because chances are that our perception of community and the way that we engage with it probably isn't the same as what it was before the pandemic. So how has COVID changed how you experience community? Someone's written Zoom almost exclusively. Yes, definitely. Zoom probably wasn't a term that was in our repertoire pre-COVID. And again, lots of focus on that sort of online community. So yes, again, connecting through screens as opposed to that sort of physical connection. And someone says that they actually got to know their neighbours more as well. I know I personally found that during COVID. I live in an apartment block and I was able to build a lot more connections with those in my immediate apartment. And neighbourhood as well, lots more interactions with your local neighbourhood too, especially within those 5 kilometre radiuses. So I wanted to start with that to sort of really ground and have a think about how we experience community, because they can be quite sort of nebulous concepts of community justice. So I thought I wanted to start with getting back into our bodies and how we're working and interacting. And then leading on from that, you might be thinking, well, how do our sort of experience of community relate to the issues of family violence? Well, I'm glad you asked. Involving communities in the task of preventing family violence is essential. Professionals tend to need needs, so we quite enjoy the idea of needs assessments, and perhaps there's a tendency to identify groups based on their needs or deficits. But we also need to focus on what people do have, and community members can play an important role in addressing family violence by raising awareness in their communities and working towards social change. So if family violence does occur, we know that victims often reach out to those people that you were mentioning in the chat, so your friends, your neighbours, and family first for help. And during stay-at-home orders and the pandemic, neighbours played a critical role, bystander role, as perhaps many of us saw or at least heard more of our neighbours' lives. And service providers and agencies can form networks with community leaders to connect victims and perpetrators to relevant support services and ensure that those services remain accountable to and serve the needs of those various communities. And I'll be providing some examples of what this looks like at the NJC. So family violence has a ripple effect. It results in major health, social, financial, social consequences for individuals, families, and the communities as a whole. In the city of Yarra, family violence is a critical health and human rights issue, and this is made more complex by the high levels of diversity and social polarisation in the area. We know that family violence occurs across all ages, socioeconomic and demographic groups. However, it is most often perpetrated by men against women and children. And Nick will talk further about men who use violence today. And while family violence can happen anywhere and to anyone, it is more severe in certain sections of society. So any conversation that we're going to have about family violence needs to bring in that idea of intersectionality, which helps explain why certain populations, such as cold populations, Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander peoples, LGBTIQ plus communities, people experiencing disabilities, and people from disadvantaged socioeconomic backgrounds are targeted for violence at higher rates and often experience additional barriers when seeking help. So this table here indicates the rate of family violence incidents in Yarra over time compared with the orange line, which represents Victoria as a whole. So you can see here, as Magistrate Tui mentioned, that these incidents, reporting of family violence to police did increase over COVID from 2020. And in Yarra, there are over 1,000 incidents reported by police in 2021, which is one every 8 hours. But this data likely only represents the tip of the iceberg, as we know that the majority of incidents of family violence go unreported. And during lockdowns as well, victim survivors had less opportunities to report. So while this data is one piece of the puzzle, it doesn't tell us the full picture. And for that, we need to collect additional data and information from our community. So that takes us to our approach in practice. So the NJC takes a multifaceted approach to family violence. As Magistrate Tui mentioned, there's no quick fix. So there's a recognition that improving the way family violence matters are handled in the court system is important, but we also need to do more than that as well. So there's a broadened role for a community justice court in helping to increase access to family violence services in the region and in supporting agencies to be responsive to all communities in relation to family violence matters. And this includes working with local government, community agencies, and of course, community members. And to give you an idea of what that looks like, I thought I'd start first with my position. So a dedicated family violence position was created some time ago to further NJC's community work in this area. My predecessor, Marie Foles, led this work under the then title of the Family Violence Partnerships Coordinator. And today you'll be hearing about some of her work in this space. I myself joined the NJC in the last week of May in 2021. So I've been at the centre now for 8 months. And to work effectively, myself and the other members of our team need to wear a number of hats, sometimes multiple hats at once. And I'll be going into what this might look like in practice and those examples from the next slides, but I wanted to give an overview first of these different roles. So, firstly, my role might be as a project leader. So this is driving the project throughout the life cycle from inception to evaluation. And one example of this is the COVID-19 Yarra Community Response Network, which was formed by Marie and my manager Heng in 2020 to connect service group providers in the city of Yarra. And this network had 34 organisations, over 80 members, and they were able to get the network up and running in a week due to the strong existing relationships and ties that NJC has with partners in the community. My role might also be as a supporting partner. This includes advising, providing materials, spaces, and/or funding. We might also be a broker, bringing together parties with common needs and interests. And we also do capacity building work as well. So providing forums, training to encourage information exchange and the development of skills, knowledge and networks. We may also be a participant as well, involved in networks and consultative groups, contributing expertise and knowledge. One example of NJC's role as a supporting partner and as a capacity builder is the Living in Harmony project. This project occurred some time ago, but it's such a great example of those place-based, strength-based approaches that Beck was talking about that I wanted to share it with you today. So this three-year project was supervised by CoHealth, which was then North Yarra Community Health. And the NJC played the role of a supporting partner and also as a capacity builder, as NJC staff were involved in some of the training of community facilitators. And the NJC also contributed partial funding, and Marie chaired the project steering committee as part of this project. So by way of background, the community members and workers had expressed interest in further opportunities for education in relation to family violence on the housing estate for newly arrived and called communities particularly. And in response, the Living in Harmony project was created. So this project identified 16 community leaders, and they were recruited and trained to work with their communities in order to raise awareness of the impact of family violence and the support services available, build respectful relationships, and take a united stand against family violence. So this project recognised that community leaders, as respected and trusted members of their communities, are a valuable resource for fostering harmony and safety throughout the estate, particularly through the role they can play in shaping understandings, attitudes, behaviours and practices that protect against family violence and minimise its risks. And the community facilitators had strong links with and knowledge of their own communities. And together with their initiatives and ideas for projects, this really contributed to the success and the outcomes that were achieved. So Living in Harmony is a great example of working with and learning from these leaders within communities to ensure that projects are relevant to and tailored to those particular communities. In addition to working with residents, the NJC also works closely with family violence workers and different organisations in Yarra. So the Yarra Family Violence Network is an example of NJC's work to enhance responses to family violence via collaboration. And as part of my role, I'm the chair and convener of this network. So the NJC leads this project and also plays a broker role. There are a number of stakeholders involved in family violence prevention and responses, from police, courts, different services, and workers can also be isolated, particularly during COVID. So my role is to act as a liaison between services so that we can share information and work together, promoting a regional response to addressing family violence. This network was established quite some time ago in 2007, and it's one of several local family violence networks within the Northern Metropolitan region. And initially Yarra City Council hosted the network, then NJC became a co-convener, and then finally the sole convener of this network. And participation in the network's open to all workers in the city of Yarra with a role in addressing family violence. So if that is you, feel free to get in touch after the webinar. We meet monthly to better understand the situation. So taking these overlaying data sets and what we're seeing on the ground in order to get a fuller picture of what's really happening. We also coordinate, find ways to align and work together differently to fill service gaps and to enhance services and ultimately how we serve the needs of community. And the Living in Harmony project, which I just mentioned, was initiated via this particular network. So the network assisted in setting up a formal reference group to write submissions and funding for the project. And as well as convening networks, I also participate in a number of regional and local networks. So the Yarra Family Violence Network primarily focus on responding to family violence, whereas this the Building Respectful Community partnership is more about prevention of family violence. So the NJC is a member of this partnership, and it's a voluntary alliance of organisations in the region that are committed to implementing the strategy. So what is the strategy? The strategy applies a regional approach to preventing violence against women. And our region, the Northern Metropolitan Region, launched its third strategy yesterday. So that will be the 2022 to 2026 strategy. NJC's position is unique in the sense that courts traditionally are seen as focusing on responses to family violence after violence has occurred, as opposed to preventing violence from occurring. And as the only court in the partnership, the NJC is able to provide a unique perspective to other members. And we also benefit from being part of the collective regional action to prevent violence against women, which feeds into and informs the work that we do on the ground. Involving communities in the task of preventing family violence is essential. Whether communities are defined by places, workplaces, population groups with a shared ethos or interest, the culture they established can have a powerful influence on the behaviour of individuals. Cultural change will not happen without community-led prevention action. And that's from the Royal Commission into Family Violence. So, if you take one thing away from today, I'd invite you to consider how you can start with community in your work. If you work for an agency, which I think many of us here today do, think about what does your organisation do and what more could it do to work in ways that are strength-based and community-driven. That's all from me. I'll hand over now to Nick.
Thanks, Sophie, and thank you, Madison Tui and Beck, for the introduction. I too would like to pay my respects to the Aboriginal people, the traditional owners of the land of where I gather today, the Wurundjeri people of the Kulin Nation, and pay my respects to elders past, present and emerging. And I would also like to, I guess, when Sophie finished off there with thinking about communities, responding to family violence, to also recognise the strength that is within Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander communities to lead the change in sort of addressing family violence as well, because that can often be left out. I work for No to Violence, and as Beck said earlier, I'm based at the Neighbourhood Justice Centre 4 days a week, and I also spend one day a week at my head office at No to Violence in Melbourne. But today I'm just going to give a brief overview, I guess, of what the role looks like at the Neighbourhood Justice Centre when working with men. I just wanted to open up with this question here. And look, unfortunately, we're not going to have time to answer, the question here today, but just for yourself to sort of personally reflect on this question and, what do you think some of the answers are for this? What do male respondents require in order to change their use of family violence? So just have a think about that for the rest of this session. Okay, so with my role, I can talk about the referral pathways internally and externally. So internally, I can receive referrals through the magistrate, also through the lawyers, other service providers that are located at the Neighbourhood Justice Centre. Also occasionally external providers will also sort of refer men to myself. So there's a different sort of ways in which I can sort of engage with men. It's not just internally at the Neighbourhood Justice Centre, but they do need to be living within the city of Yarra. Occasionally they might be out of the city of Yarra for a period of time, or the incident might have taken place in the city of Yarra, but they do need to be sort of within the city of Yarra. So the type of engagement that I do with men, it can be in person and over the phone. Prior to COVID, it was, most of the engagement was in person. And so there would be sort of scheduled sessions where the men would come in and sort of meet with me and have those sessions that could be weekly, fortnightly, depending on where the man is at and what type of approach needs to be sort of working with him. So it is a client-centered approach. And then I'll also will engage with other support services at the Neighbourhood Justice Centre as well. I suppose during COVID, that has changed slightly. So it has been more over the phone, and that's just because I haven't been able to sort of see men in person. So I guess there's been pros and cons to that for potentially the respondent, but also the practitioner myself. So I guess one of the pros around that is being able to sort of have more accessibility and flexibility in being able to sort of engage with the man. And one of the cons around that, though, is there might not be as much accountability if you're having conversations with men over the phone as opposed to in person, where I guess you get to sort of really sort of gauge more where he's at and what's been going on for him. So the court support on the day we have our family violence matters are generally heard on a Tuesday. So what I would be doing is I would be on the court floor during those days, and I would be going up and approaching men who are about to have their matters heard. So as you can imagine, I guess the men during that time are probably feeling quite anxious. They could be quite emotional. They could be quite sort of nervous. The incident might have occurred the previous night, and then all of a sudden they're at court, and they could have been excluded from their home. They might be want to be able to see their children. So there could be a lot going on for the man when he is, you know, coming to court on that day. So my approach during that is I go up and introduce myself. I sort of let him know the support that I can offer. Whether he wants to take that on board or not is sort of up to him. Then I will often sort of liaise with the lawyers around whether, you know, he's willing to engage or not, and then we can sort of take that further. And then on the Tuesday, I try to see or speak to as many men as possible. And then I can also, you know, report back to, you know, Magistrate Tui if he's willing to engage or not. And then we can sort of go from there. Occasionally it might actually just be brief interventions on the day. So I will, you know, have a bit of an idea of what's been going on for him. And I will also try to, I guess, provide those brief interventions to ensure the safety, you know, for the women and children, and also himself. So that's really important on that initial engagement. Part of the role as well is also report writing, and this can be for the magistrate. So that could be like in the form of like a progress report. So the matter could be adjourned for you know, a few weeks or a few months, where you know, the magistrate might want to see what his level of engagement looks like, whether he has been attending appointments, whether he's actively engaged and so forth, whether there's other referrals that have been put in place. So I will, you know, quite often write reports for the magistrate to get a, you know, better understanding of where he's at and how he's been tracking. Within that report writing, they can often be combined with other support workers at the Neighbourhood Justice Centre as well. So as an example, he may be working with a drug and alcohol worker. So we would sort of collaborate together to put those reports for the magistrate to be able to sort of, I guess, you know, track the progress. Now, quite often I can sort of provide several reports, again, sort of depending on how he's going and whether, I guess, the magistrate would like to see more information on him. So that at the NJC, we have a risk assessment meeting on a Tuesday morning. So who attends a risk assessment meeting will be a counsellor, case manager from CoHealth, who will chair the meeting. We also have a Berry Street worker who works with, you know, the affected family member, so generally the women or children. We also have Elizabeth Morgan House, who will attend that meeting as well. And sometimes we will have the LGBTIQ plus team who will also attend the meeting in the morning. So a lot of the work is done prior to the Tuesday morning on the Monday, I guess, being able to sort of have a look at the police narratives, being able to sort of assess what the, you know, level of risk is, and then we sort of, you know, meet up first thing in the morning on a Tuesday to you know, have a look at what supports are currently in place or what supports need to be in place. When I do, you know, speak to the respondent initially, when I'm introducing what I do, it is, again, try to do it as warm as possible and also give him the choice while also being able to sort of, I guess, you know, challenge him as well. But essentially what I'm trying to do is build rapport with him initially, but also just take in mind to not sort of collude with him. So that can be the difficulty, I guess, within the role, because quite often, you know, you're I guess, the way that I like to look at it is sometimes I like to throw a hook out to him and try to get him to come on board with me for further engagement, but at the same time, just not sort of colluding with him. So what he might do, some examples of what collusion might look like, he might use the language like, mate, brother, you know what it's like. You know what it's like when you know, she says this or she's annoying or I was drunk at the time. So really trying to sort of get you on board with them. So I guess you've got to be aware to not collude with him, because it's not going to be beneficial for the work that he's doing himself. So another sort of big part that I do there is throughout the whole engagement initially and through the ongoing engagement is obviously just identifying the risk to others and also himself. So I'm constantly, you know, asking, you know, is he aware of the IVO conditions, what they look like, and so that he isn't sort of in breach at all, but also his own sort of well-being. So always at the forefront of the work is the safety of the women and children, and obviously himself too. During the assessment as well, I will, you know, provide some psychoeducation on family violence for the respondent. You know, quite often the men will come to me and say, look, I'm not a violent person. I would never hit my partner. I would never do anything like that. I'm a really kind man and so forth. So I guess you sort of provide more information on the different types of family violence so that they can gain a greater understanding themselves. And then what it can do is, I guess, lead to sort of, you know, what those indicators and motivation for change may look like. So we do talk about, you know, what the coercive behaviours look like. And quite often men will come in and they just won't have that insight into what constitutes family violence. So a big part of my role is that, and then it can open up other doors for this man to address his behaviour. One of the things that I do there as well is, I guess it's not just the civil matters within family violence. So quite often men might have some criminal matters that are being heard at the Neighbourhood Justice Centre as well, or it could even be other courts. So I guess I will be following him through that journey too, which, you know, is something a little bit unique to the role at the NJC. So here there's quite a few different service providers at the Neighbourhood Justice Centre. So to give you a bit of a sort of, I guess, snapshot, we all sit on the same level. Okay, so it's been strategically sort of set out where, you know, we all sit quite closely together. So as an example, I will sit directly next to the Berry Street worker who works with the affected family members. I also sit closely with the LGBTIQ plus family violence team. So they're sort of right there next to me as well. So I guess the benefit of that is that things happen really quickly. So I can speak to the Berry Street worker around sort of any potential risks with the respondent, and that way we can sort of work closely around sort of the necessary referrals, and also just to give greater insight into what's actually happening sort of right now if the work has spoken to the AFM. So as you can see there, there's different service providers. I won't go through sort of each one, but again, I just wanted to sort of highlight that the benefit for me as a practitioner is great, just knowing that we're all on the same floor and we sit really closely together, and it just cuts those times out of having to make phone calls, send emails and so forth, which we know can often be a downfall in this type of work. And just to have their expertise, you know, particularly as an example, there could be the St. Vincent's mental health worker who's there, and I can always just, you know, bounce stuff off them straight away if I have concerns around sort of mental health or what referral pathways might look like. I work closely with the Fitzroy Legal Service team and, you know, Victorian Legal Aid, and also Corrections Victoria there. So you could have men that will be on orders, and quite often the workers may refer men to myself if they're having difficulty getting into other programs, or we could just work sort of collaboratively with that man, and I can give them some advice and sort of best practice when working with him. Just down the bottom there, I've highlighted the Interact database. So this was designed and developed at the Neighbourhood Justice Centre, and I believe it's actually sort of being rolled out to other specialist courts as well. But essentially what that is it's a live platform that's been put together, and it's utilised on family violence days on the Tuesday. And who has access to that is the registry, so court registry. You've got the lawyers. You've also got the support workers. And we can sort of, you know, let each other know exactly what's going on the day for that matter. So the police prosecutors also have access to that. And it's like a live platform, which has been really useful and efficient on family violence hearing days. And particularly during COVID, obviously, you know, we've all been sort of working from home. So that has also been a really useful tool as well. Just before I finish up, I just wanted to sort of also mention Neighbourhood Violence, who I work for. So we are the sort of national peak body for, you know, addressing men's use of family violence. So what Neighbourhood Violence has is the inbound family violence counselling service. So that's around the clock 24/7. So there's trained counsellors that are there to talk to men about their use of family violence. Often they can be self-referred. We can also sort of receive referrals from the police in Victoria, New South Wales and Tasmania, through different portals that have been set up. Neighbourhood Violence has also just set up an office in South Australia. And we've also just started doing the brief intervention service. So what the brief intervention service is there could be a respondent who may be on a waiting list for a men's behaviour change program, and he could be in a bit of limbo where he really wants some support at the moment, but he's having trouble sort of accessing those services. So what the brief intervention service is that counsellors will be able to provide some counselling sessions for him, and that could be sort of, you know, 6 to 8 sessions over the phone, where he can sort of, again, sort of gain some more insight into his use of family violence. So yeah, that has sort of taken off. And because we did notice that there was a gap with men just not being able to sort of talk to anybody about it. The last one there is a men's accommodation and counselling service. So this has been in collaboration with the St Kilda Crisis Centre, which again is sort of located in Melbourne. So that's sort of specifically set up for men who may have been excluded from the family home and they've got nowhere to go. And then we would be sort of speaking to the St Kilda Crisis Centre where they could, you know, put him up in some short-term accommodation on the proviso that he does engage with one of the counsellors at Neighbourhood Violence. So it's a really short-term stay. Again, it could be sort of leading up into the court case, up to a week sort of generally. It could be around sort of 3 to 4 nights. But again, it's just giving him the opportunity to be able to speak to a family violence trained counsellor about his use and put the safety measures in place. So I think that's it. It was a bit of a brief overview of sort of what happens at the NJC. There's obviously a lot more to it, but that's a bit of a snapshot of my role. So thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Nick. Also, thank you, Sophie and Magistrate Tui, for your very thoughtful presentations today. You've given us so much to consider and to think about. Also, if any of the information today, if you found anything distressing or if you need support, remember you can call 1-800-RESPECT on 1-800-737-732. We also have popped up, there's a men's referral service number there for you, which is 1-300-766-491. If you're in the city of Yarra and you need help regarding family violence, please call the information team, our front desk at the NJC, to speak to a family violence practitioner in our client services team. And the number for the NJC is 9948 8777. And also Shaz can pop those numbers. We'll put them in the chat, and we can also send them out to you in our email as well. If you would like to learn more about the NJC model, you can see our email address there. So please make contact with us via the education team, and we will respond to any inquiry that you have if you send that through. Thank you again, and we look forward to seeing you again very soon.